Welcome back to our special discussion on the state of the economy. We have been speaking with Indranil Sengupta of Bank of America Merill Lynch, Sachchidanand Shukla of Mahindra Group, and Abhishek Upadhyay of ICICI Securities primary dealer. The question we are asking is, with GST taxes consistently falling below target and the government cutting its borrowing program for the first half next year, could we have a problem in terms of government spending boost? Our experts believe that government could well live with a higher fiscal deficit. All right, but now we come to the second half of next year. Abhishek, you know, what you have, there is a reason why traditionally governments have borrowed more in the first half, up to maybe 60-65%. Now we are drastically reducing it to 50. Governments borrowed less because at that time, private sector doesn't borrow. Cement, construction, mining, sugar, so many industries don't work from April to September. Now you're going to have a double whammy of borrowing possibly in the second half. Do you fear yields will rise next year, October onwards?
No, so Latha, it will be a combination of factors. There are various moving parts here. First, inflation. Our assessment is that, you know, second half, latter part of next fiscal, you should see the inflationary impact of MSP hikes. Yet the details are not out. But we believe that based on whatever information we have, inflation impact you should see over mostly the second half around the harvest season. The borrowing has been postponed as well to the second half, and we expect a fiscal breach. So the confluence of factors do indicate that, you know, at least the downside is capped. In the near term, the optimism could sustain because globally the U.S. yields have basically been in a range now. They seem to have stabilized in a range. Crude prices have to be watched closely, but they are still broadly around 70 odd levels. And inflation, while inflation will go up near term, we still think that it will be base effects. It will not be MSP driven or real demand driven inflation that we'll see over the next 3-4 months. Okay. So the factors that we are talking about are mostly mostly worrying in the second half, and I do believe that yields should therefore increase towards the latter part of next fiscal. What exact levels, very difficult to say at this stage.
Okay. Indranil, similar question to you, but with a slightly longer longer period focus. There is a reason why the buyback was done, because there is a bunching up of redemptions. For the last 2-3 years, governments have been buying back with the cash so that there is less of redemption pressure in the following year. Now for FY20, we are preparing ourselves for a bit of a problem, aren't we? You're buying back less, 25,000 crore is likely to get redeemed. But more importantly, we're going to issue shorter term paper. So redemptions could increase in terms of 1 year paper and less than 2 year paper, even maturing in FY20. Are we just kicking the can down and making life difficult both in the second half of FY19 and FY20?
You know, just to take the second half of FY19, we are very bullish on yields. My view is that, you know, there are three big drivers for yields to go down. Number one, inflation has clearly peaked off. And, you know, while it will go up on base effects, in the June quarter, everyone can, you know, anyone can do the math and see that this is base effects.
Sure. Okay.
So if the monsoons are normal, we think the RBI will cut rates in August. So that's number one. Number two is that, you know, we think that FX intervention this year is going to be much lower than last year, something around $15 billion versus $30 billion odd last year. So we believe that the RBI will come in and have to do OMO again of around $20-25 billion.
Okay.
So that will, you know, create excess demand in the G-Sec market. So that's number two. Number three, when it comes to, you know, the maturity profile, yes, you know, at the end of the day, you know, we are moving to shorter maturities, moving away from, you know, looking at years of, you know, buckets where maturities were less.
Okay.
But in a post-LCR world, there is not anything else that you can do because, you know, at the end of the day, once you start doing asset liability management under LCR, you will have to shorten duration. Maybe this time the duration was also partly shortened because of the spike in yields.
Okay. Or, yeah, of course.
But
that,
generally very bullish on yields from here on.
Oh, right. Okay, okay. And, of course, if you're expecting a rate cut, you must be bullish. Though I must say, Indranil, that from my dipstick survey, you are the outlier. Sachchidanand, you know, there is a... I mean, we seem to be heading towards a decision-making paralysis. Already you have an NPA issue. And now I'm moving away from bonds and yields. We already have accelerated recognition of NPAs and their provisioning. So to that extent, lending can crimp. But, you know, we've spoken to several bankers who are trying to ask state governments to buy up power sector, power companies that will go to NCLT. They are trying to seek some kind of help from the central government. The answer bankers get is nobody wants to help any of the groups because they will be accused of cronyism. There seems to be definitely a decision-making paralysis creeping in simply because of this wild charges of cronyism from both sides, UPA, NDA, and in the press. So do you think that factor ahead of an election is going to stymie growth? What are your growth numbers anyway for FY19?
We are looking at a 7.2 kind of a number. And I understand your concerns when you talk about indecision and things like that, which might continue, especially on the banking side. Nobody really wanting to take any decisions when you are likely to be hauled up and charged with indiscretion. But having said that, I think the real worries would probably be, so just look at how things are going to pan out. May you have Karnataka elections. If there is an accident, I mean, something that is not really in line with market expectations, you can see an adverse reaction on the growth as well as the interest rate bit. Moving forward, you're again looking at the midterm elections in the US, and then you have the big ones in MP and Rajasthan and things like that. So if you were to chart it out, I think we are going to gradually enter into a situation or a time zone wherein these could actually have a big impact on growth and the decision making part. But having said that, I think the real thing is the government is saving its ammo for the second half. Expenditure is going to be the key. In a typical election year, you've seen about 16.5% kind of growth. This year, we're talking about 10%, which I think, so while we continue to focus on the revenue numbers, the expenditure part is the one where you should be focusing on in second half.
Okay. All right. But 7.2, that means that FY19 is not looking way brighter and certainly lower than the early RBI estimates of 7.4 that we got. Abhishek, putting all these things together, is the best of growth behind us? That's the statement actually I got from Credit Suisse after their recent investor conference. Is FY19 going to be better than FY18?
No, we are quite optimistic on FY19 simply because FY19 could be the first year in last 4 years where you don't have a disruption from monsoons or from GST and demonetization kind of shocks. So FY19 could be disruption free from that perspective. You have a good momentum heading into FY19. The consumption indicators have been faring pretty well. Exports should do better as system stabilizes to GST. Right. So and capex, we don't think can be an incremental drag from here. If you look at capex to GDP, it has been more or less flat for the last 3 years now.
Sure.
So even capex, you know, should start to trend higher heading into the next fiscal. So overall, we think that recovery will be more broad based. Led by consumption, but capex would be an incremental positive driver as well. So we are at 7.5% GDP growth for FY19. So we surely don't think best of growth is behind us for now yet.
Okay, Indranil, just half a minute. What kind of a growth are you expecting in FY19 vis-a-vis FY18?
So we are looking at growth going to 7.5 in the first half and falling to 7% in the second half.
Okay.
Once the base effects are done.
All right.
So 7.2 all in all.
All right. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me in this discussion. Things can pan out tough with election year, probably decision-making paralysis, higher yields because of higher borrowing in the second half, and the general kicking of the can to the next year in terms of borrowing load, lower tax collection. or it could pan out that elections work in favor of the ruling party in the Karnataka elections. It gives them a spring in the step, lower yields, as Indranil was telling us, economic momentum, as Abhishek is pointing out, higher exports, and therefore the economy doing well. We will have to see which scenario picks up. At the moment, the worry just is that we are not doing so well on taxes. Thank you very much for watching this special show on the state of the economy. Stay tuned to CNBC TV 18. More news and analysis follows. We'll be right back.